Hey everyone, episode 19, and it's the Valentine's Day special. We go through our top 10 rom-com films of all time. We also look at when Valentine's Day marketing goes wrong. And to ruin all of that romance, we've got a crazy clip from The Jerry Springer Show. Grab your partner and a bottle of wine and jump right in.
Choose the fat.
Boys, boys, boys.
And girls too.
And girls, and girls, girls, girls too. Because it's Valentine's Day, baby.
Love is in the air. Episode 19.
Two different theme songs.
Yeah, I got the wrong one. I got it wrong.
50-50. 50-50. He goes wrong. For our Spanish listeners, what's episode 19?
Diecinueve.
And for our Spanish listeners, what is Valentine's Day?
A crock of
No, we can't.
Sorry.
Come on.
Valentine's Day,
for 40 minutes. Can't you just open your little frozen heart?
Let the love in.
It's a market's wet dream.
It is a market's wet dream.
What it is.
Make it Valentine's Day every day, Sam.
Well, it's...
It already is for him.
Yeah.
He does doesn't he?
I wake up speaking to wildlife and skipping to work, don't I?
Then they take your towel off in the morning.
I haven't done laundry in 6 years. They just do it all for me.
You're basically a Disney princess. Yeah. I really enjoy that.
But the only thing is, you get muddy squirrels prints all over your shirts when they try to fold them.
These are the bits they don't show you.
Yeah. They need to have a little cleaning ledge as they come in. Otherwise, it's all gone out the window.
Wipe their feet on the windowsill.
Cleaning ledge.
But Valentine's Day.
Way off real quick.
Yeah.
we've recently started off with a lot of men watching us.
Mm.
Pause. I'm anti-pause, but
we're not doing pause.
A lot of men watching us because obviously we're three guys, but we've got a lot of women followers recently. Loads on Instagram.
Well, do the applause. Oh well,
which is not. Mainly, I think.
I don't know who we're applauding, us or them or everybody. Yeah. Everybody.
Hey. Everyone.
Thank you.
I think that's mainly for when Ben gets his legs out.
All right. Okay.
We want the legs.
But I think today's gonna be an episode that the women are gonna like.
Hopefully.
And if men don't like it, they're lying to themselves because it's Valentine's Day. And we're going to do top 10 rom-coms, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
Share this pod with a lover or a friend that you would like to be a lover.
Well.
We'll talk about some of that.
Yeah. It's funny you should say that.
Oh, is it? Right, okay.
Because I've been listening to some hip-hop music this week.
Oh, shit.
And I did a bit of a radio, you know, when you song radio. Uh-huh. And this song came up, which was Lovers and Friends.
Oh, no way.
Tell me again.
Big tune.
Usher. Ludacris and Lil Jon, and it's basically they did so this guy, he's heard it. And then this was their they write back basically,
but it's a
completely slower one. It's like it's basically trying to be a bit of a
I didn't know there was like a connection between those two.
Yeah, I think at the start they go, we had to do it again, right?
Oh,
and they do, but what I love is, I mean, the playlist was very Usher heavy, which is obvious for obvious reasons, like just great R&B, like good music to like, you know, babe making music. Everyone's got that on the playlist. But what I loved was Lil Jon doing a verse, which is so Lil Jon.
God.
But it's also,
it's a great verse.
But it's also like, if you take the context, there's some like heartfelt sweet bits in it. And just the joining of these worlds.
I didn't know he had it in him.
So,
Wait till you hear it.
Okay, yeah, all right, yeah.
So I need you to come in with shawty.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So, I've been known you for a long time.
Shawty.
But fucking never crossed my mind.
Shawty.
But tonight I see sun in you.
Shawty.
That make me want to get with you.
Shawty.
You ain't been nothing but a friend of me.
Shawty.
And a brother never ever dreamed we'd be. Up in a kissing, hugging, squeezing, touching. Up in the bathtub, rubber-dubbing. Lil Jon talking about rubber-dubbing.
Trying to make it sound all nice-like, you know?
I didn't enjoy any of that. That's
just the idea.
Lil Jon
writing sweet nothings into his notepad. With his grills.
Spilling his stanky cup, whatever he's got in it.
Stanky cup. Thing is, that was more romantic than I was expecting.
That's why it's so funny.
Yeah, you can't say song. It in that with that voice either.
Yeah. And then just break up every line with shouting. God, I listened to a few of his songs because that came up quite a lot on the radio. And a lot of them are quite cute and sweet in the narrative of the song. But then he comes in
and just like bulldozes
like an Atlanta wrecking ball. Could you, just imagine him trying to be sweet, though? Because everyone likes a cuddle, right? Let's be honest. Everyone likes a bit of affection every now and again.
With
the right,
me,
with the right person.
Yeah, fair.
But you can't imagine someone like Lil Jon.
He'd have all his chains on as well,
wouldn't he? All his chains on. His sunglasses are on.
Yeah.
He's got a backwards cap on.
Yeah.
Boxers, big trainers.
Boxers and shorts that are halfway down in bed still.
Yeah. Half a spliff.
So, that's it.
And then he's going, hey, girl.
He can't ever be relaxed, can he?
No.
With all that jury on. Maybe. Good Ludacris verse in that as well.
No, oh, it's a great song. Lovers and Friends. Ludacris, do you know they do a festival, Lovers and Friends?
It's amazing. In Vegas.
It's everybody. It's anyone who's everyone.
Anyone that's made a good R&B or hip-hop song from 95 to 2005 is on there.
Fair.
I think it is Usher and Ludacris that have actually like co-signed
it's in
the
Vegas.
Festival.
I would love to go.
Yeah, we looked at it 1 year, but but yeah, just goes to show that everyone out there can show a bit of love.
Yeah, even Lil Jon.
Not just the soft boys. And the, what are the boys called when they're all soppy? What's the phrase? The simps.
Ah, simps. Oh.
Yes.
The modern phenomena of simping.
Yeah. So if you're simping, beta, alpha, Lil Jonner.
Lil Jon.
There's something for everyone on February 14th.
As long as you love a shawty and a shawty love you.
That's all you need.
That's all you need, baby.
Shawty. But, so we think of Valentine's Day now as a bit of a sham, right?
Yeah, unfortunately, that's kind of the stigma of it, yeah.
Why would you say that?
Because it's just market. Like you said, it's just a marketing thing, isn't it?
Yeah, really. Yeah. But the interesting part is I did a bit of digging into the history of Valentine's Day, and I thought it was going to be a modern phenomenon.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because that's how it feels, right? It
is just Valentine.
Yeah. But actually, it goes right back to 269 AD. They can't pinpoint it to one person. There's three different saints that all get called Saint Valentine because you get called, the saint name is not your normal name.
Right.
They call you the saint after you die.
Yeah.
And they were martyrs, basically. Yep. So this is when Christianity was just starting out. One of them...
There wasn't a Saint Chaudet, was there?
No. When Lil Jon dies... I'm trying to think of some Latin to say.
I don't think Lil Jon and Latin have ever crossed paths. Grulsus,
Rimsus, Purple Drankus, Invictus, Memorandum.
Purple Drankus.
But yeah, so basically the rough history, quick one, is basically there was a martyr in Rome. And this is when like the Romans are starting to phase out and Christianity is obviously coming in a little bit. And it was illegal for Christians to marry like in a Christian ceremony.
Right.
And this guy was basically marrying Christians that were in love away from the Romans and eventually got killed for it. And he was the first acknowledged Saint Valentine. So that's where the link to it being about love.
Oh, this is quite a deep, like a rich history.
So then in the 8th century is the first time it was in the 14th of February. Mm. So there's a feast of Saint Valentine's. The day got associated with love in the 14th century. So a little bit more concretely associated with love. Because apparently the lovebirds of early spring around that time.
Oh, so is that why it's right.
So
February?
There's a few... So apparently in February,
spring is coming.
Yeah, you might be the first sound of bird after a bit of a bleak winter.
Yeah.
Maybe. Mm-hmm. But then this is where it gets interesting. So it wasn't in 18th century England. We were the first ones to share gifts with your loved ones. So again, essentially... The materialistic side of it now started in England.
Mm. In the 18th century, that's a long time ago.
Yeah, exactly.
So like, what were they gifting back then, you know?
Well,
cabbage?
Flowers and confectionery.
Okay.
You were born in the wrong era.
Why? Gifting cabbage?
No, you like confectionery.
Oh, right.
For God's sake.
Mind you, it wouldn't be as sweet as a Mr. Kipling, would it?
No, there's no cherry bakewells.
No, exactly.
It would have been a piece of bark dipped in sugar or something.
And then that was the first piece of bark dipped in sugar. I see you've had sugar bark before. No sugar bark before your dinner. You'll ruin your appetite. Tiny Tim.
Sugar bark. Absolute nonsense. That's so good.
I'm picturing like a knight winning a jousting tournament and just going, sugar bark. Oh, no calories.
I won this joust because I was high on sugar bark.
Only moderately taste of bark.
I get the power to joust from sugar bark.
Now available in raspberry and cool watermelon.
It towers ocean across breeze. The land. Ocean breeze.
But yeah, so we were the first ones around that time to send a Valentine's Day card.
Oh,
right?
Okay.
And apparently, according Valentine's Day card, they're cute for kids, aren't they?
We screwed it all up, didn't we? What were they doing?
Yeah, well, I guess...
Putting this all together.
But if we weren't doing this, what would we be doing instead then? If we weren't gifting gifts and
gifting
cards?
Gifting out venereal diseases, probably.
That happens anyway.
Or the plague.
The plague, have some of this.
Have some leprosy.
My loved one.
No, there's something quite cute about the essence of it, right? You know, it's that unrequited love in school, you give out something. But in practice, in adult life, it's just... It has become this mega kind of...
It's just like everything else now, isn't it? It's all just a market.
Yeah, same as Christmas.
But I think kind of what you were just saying with the cards when you was in school and that, like when you send, like the good bit about Valentine's is giving something without like knowing who it is.
Sort of thing. Secrecy.
But obviously now it's more about your actual partner who you're with. Yeah. So it's a bit more face to face, but
Do you think that still exists though? Is it more that like that now because of our age? Do kids still do that?
I imagine so. I imagine it's a sweet thing for primary school teachers to
do.
Whose dick is this on the dick pic?
Well, I'm picturing like 9-year-olds.
That's what I meant too.
Well, I wasn't going that young. I was going like adolescent kids at school.
You still pretty bad.
Yeah, still minors, Dean.
Yes.
God damn it. God damn it. But so Hallmark apparently says it's the second biggest card giving holiday after Christmas. Wow. So they make a fortune. We associate it Valentine's Day with Cupid, hearts, flowers, doves. Mm-hmm. In Italy, keys. So it's like unlocking someone's heart, which is the Italians are a bit more romantic than us, aren't they? A little bit more.
I guess you do see that stuff as well, don't you? You see like heart-shaped locks with keys to do. No?
I've got no time for that, babe.
Yeah, gotcha. Yeah. Bridge too far.
Nice. Real nice. Going to a public bridge and just leaving a padlock on.
Yeah.
And someone's job is to cut them all off. You know that he's single, don't you, guy?
Of course. He's fuming.
Claire, just throw them all in the river.
Claire
well?
And Mark, see how long you last now.
Do you reckon, like in Hercules, you know, when he cuts the hair, that the entire relationship just falls apart.
Dies. Yeah, yeah.
You've seen that too much recently.
But, yeah.
Once too many times, yeah.
This is, I've got average amounts that couples spend on each other.
Ooh.
So this is my current issue, right? Mm-hmm. I think Valentine's Day is a lovely sentiment. You should not need a day, but it's always nice to have a day. If you are in a relationship, if you're not being funny, suck it up. It's one day, you get over it. But if you are and you have someone you like, why not have a day where you just take a bit of time, show a bit of appreciation, write something sweet in a card.
Mm.
But when it's like, oh, I bought you a pair of new trainers or I bought you this bag or like something materialistic.
Yeah.
We're no longer at that sentiment point, are we? We're just having a second Christmas at this point.
Yeah, true.
And we're probably in a relationship where we're so insecure because we don't actually ever communicate properly that we've got to do. No, but it is that type of stuff though. The boy did good.
Boy done good, yeah.
You know, so it's quite interesting, right? So how much do you think, there's a big disparity here. How much do you think the average man spends on his woman?
Is this split up by geography?
Not necessarily on his woman. How much does he reckon this was an American?
Fine, yeah.
This was an American.
So we're just going to say it's an American. So this is based from.
And it's based in heterosexual couples. I will say that as well, because it's basically men spending on women and women spending on men.
Okay.
They're the two caveats. So how much do you think the average man in. I've converted it to pounds as well, so it's easier for us.
Okay. That seems for some reason somewhat more complicated. I would say $150.
Okay.
We're doing it. Pounds?
Pounds, what, 130, 140,
okay. Something
like that.
Yeah.
I'll go £250.
Okay.
Jesus.
So the average man spends £154 on Valentine's Day, which for me is crazy. Like, some nice flowers and a card, 20 quid. Maybe then you go for dinner, but that's always a 50-50 split because that's it's an equal day. No one should be paying for someone on Valentine's Day, in my opinion.
I hear that.
Well, also my cynical nature towards statistics means It's completely untrue. And because what have we done? Serving
what did
a
you ask? 350 million Americans?
Bunch
did
of
you?
Blokes no. have just gone. Yeah, no, about $200. Yeah, $200. Yeah,
yeah. But let's entertain that. Yeah, yeah, I think the more interesting part then is. I think the more interesting part, though, is the disparity between how much women spend on the other hand. So what would your guesses for women in pounds be?
I feel like you're going to stump me. Like, you'll have led me down the garden path here. So, but I'm going to say $99.99.
I'll probably say 50 or 60 quid.
Okay. Well, very close. £68.
Yeah.
So basically, almost just over a third of what men spend.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, because...
it's not marketed towards us. Also, no. What do you buy a guy?
Yeah. What do we need really?
So we're not complaining that they're not spending that. No. But it's more like, why do some guys feel the need to spend loads, and why do some women expect loads, maybe, is the weird one. Because again, it shouldn't need to have a monetary value.
No.
It brings us onto that flower conversation though, right? Because there's a common statistic that you hear now about men only receive flowers once in their life, and it's typically
when they die.
At their funeral.
Yeah. I like flowers as well.
I was going to say, is that something that you would be happy to receive, just like flowers as a random gift?
I can't remember who's done it now. A girl has bought me flowers before, and it was like, I think I said, oh, they're nice when we're out. I don't even know what they're called, but I got them, and it was great. I think because I was living, I can't remember where I might have been living with Tom, and flowers on the kitchen table always makes the place smell and look nice. So I really appreciated it. But there was a part of me that went, is this?
Yeah.
But then that's just ego, I think.
Yeah,
maybe.
But I mean, I don't know what I was going
to
say.
I'm just experience over anything. Yeah. When it comes to anything, birthdays, Christmas with loved ones, give me experiences because I can buy my own stuff. I do.
Yeah.
Not in a like cocky way, but like, I'm going to know what I want more than you are. So let's do something together that's, you know.
Yeah, I think especially for Valentine's Day, it should be something that you do as together. Or like you said, it should be more sentimental than commercial materialistic. Yeah, 100%.
So that's when Valentine's Day goes right. But what happens when it goes wrong, Dean?
By the way, just to touch on your historical part of Valentine's, I found out that the guy who sent Valentine, who was doing the clandestine marriages or whatever.
Clandestines, there.
Hey. Yeah, but then says, or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, you were nailing it. Just, or whatever.
Do you reckon that's his, that little part of his shoulder going, let them think you're dumb.
Balance it out.
Yeah. It's hereditary now. Hey?
Imagine if he was secretly in Mensa.
It's not a secret. It is. I've seen the paper.
Anyway. It's hanging out his jacket. He just takes it around.
So the guy who was supposed to be the Valentine, Saint Valentine, like you said, he was badly beaten and decapitated.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a bummer.
Mm. So,
which, glad that you left that bit out of the story, to be honest.
Yeah. But it just further fuels...
What I would say, though, in history, Romans haven't necessarily murdered people in a nice way, by all accounts. Yeah. I mean,
they let them murder themselves by throwing them in with a bear or something. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, we didn't kill him. The bear killed him. You know what I mean?
We just closed the gate. What? Is it illegal to close a gate now?
We all cheered and ate bark, sugar bark while he fucking did it. You know what I mean?
Sugar bark. Okay.
We'll wash down this hanging with some sugar bark.
Anyway,
kids, we're going to be late for the hanging. Okay, make sure you go to the toilet and grab your sugar bark.
Thanks, Mom, I forgot.
I want you to think about how rank sugar bark would be as well. We need to really think about that for a second, right?
So, these fails that I have, they're sort of when the commercial side has failed more than anything.
Okay,
it's not like a man and woman have failed. Like, you know what I mean?
So a victim that we can all get behind.
Yeah, thank God.
Corporation.
The first one's Tesco's. So these are just some images that I found on the internet, but this is actual true. So I don't know if this is someone's cute moving of labels, but there's cucumbers on sale and it says ideal for Valentine's.
Nice.
Wow.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Take the wrapper off.
I'll leave it on.
I'll leave it on, preferably.
Yes. No, the end's really sharp, isn't it?
Yeah. You don't want that being the tip of the sword, do you? Fucking hell.
Right.
Mash up the place.
There's a
I'm not Fisher's too sure galore.
What this is, but this is Fisher. This is from a mint company. And it says, it's easier to ask for forgiveness than permission.
What's in relation? Can it,
so it's just on a pack of mints. Sweethearts. I think the mints are called sweethearts. It's easier to ask for forgiveness than permission.
Is it mainly about dark, stealing the last mint, maybe, but they've completely lost the
context is gone.
I love that you didn't have any either. Didn't have any context for that joke.
It's just a picture from a mint. A guy gets a very rapey feeling from my Valentine mint quote.
Ah, so there's the joke. Right, okay, gotcha. Awful. Yeah.
Mints don't need to be toeing that line, do they?
No, they don't.
It's supposed to keep it fresh, aren't they?
Yeah. God damn.
So this is in a card shop, on a card. A girlfriend is a sister you choose.
So missed the bit mark of Freudian on that
stuff
one.
There. Yeah.
Keeping it in the family again. Here we go. This is Durex with, this must have been for Father's Day, possibly. Share the love with your dad as a marketing for the...
No, that's definitely someone's move.
Yeah.
There is no way, because Durex are normally pretty good at... Their marketing's quite fun.
Swerving stuff.
Don't know, have a look at that. What do you reckon?
Pass it over to the marketeer.
Yeah.
God, what a dickhead.
Yeah, that was awful.
Share the three marketeers.
Yeah, it says Naki Mat on it, which I don't know what brand Naki Mat is. I'm going to quickly Google it.
What do they do on the three musketeers? What is it?
All for one and one for all.
The three marketeers.
Naki Mat.
What is it?
Kenyan supermarket chain. Nakamat is an abbreviation. Okay. It's in Kenya, so...
Yeah, maybe Durex were sharing the love with their dad in
God,
Kenya.
Imagine giving your dad some tingly lube and going, I thought of you when I saw this.
Don't know. Maybe in Kenya. And then the last one, I can't see too much on the actual thing, but when you zoom in, it just says sudden sleep and then women underneath and then there's pills in there and it's in front of like a Valentine's
section. Oh, yeah, I don't love that either.
So another consent,
another
faux pas.
Yeah.
No thanks.
I do think a lot of these have been opportunistic movers in the shops.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. Maybe people have, you know, moved stuff to somewhere else to make it
look
more like...
It's like whenever there's letters.
But, either way, why are they selling something that looks like pills with sudden sleep and then women written on it? It's just a bit mad, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, it's very mad. So that's a fail. Anyway, back to back to Sam with some lovely warm quotes of Valentine's.
I haven't got any lovely warm quotes. But I tell you what, all this talk of love, tell you who we love, you lot. Look at that.
That was good. That was
And we really do, because we actually haven't had a chance to say this to each other yet, but congratulations, we got 100,000 on YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That
in what,
is a lovely little milestone. Dang. In 3 months, we got 100,000. So thank you, everyone who has made that possible. Those little landmarks are, they actually, I didn't think I'd care, because you get to like 98,000, you're like, you know it's coming.
Yeah, yeah.
But then it's like, when you see it written down, it's pretty
when's
cool.
When's it coming?
Yeah, we all kind of had a little chat about it. It was like, oh, look, it's getting quite close now. Yeah, there was a little tip of excitement amongst us. So
yeah, that's
really
nice. But we want more, because we're greedy, aren't we? We're like the capitalist hallmark. We want more everything.
Share the love with us.
So,
your dad.
If you're on YouTube, Ben, what can they do?
Please like, comment, and subscribe. The more comments, the better. It is getting better, by the way. Seems really nice to come through.
Definitely.
Just more of that would be amazing.
Yeah, definitely. And Dean, how many stars should they give us on Apple and Spotify?
Just always give 5 stars, man. Yeah. Just give.
There's no other choice.
Just give.
5 stars if you are listening on the audio platforms. And as I say, on YouTube, 100,000, but we still haven't got 200 subscribers yet. So there's a big disparity. So all of you that do watch and consume the content, it don't take you any time. Just press subscribe and it makes our lives a lot easier, because then we can start making a little bit of money off it and we can make it even better by reinvesting into...
We can have dancers in the background. Who knows, you know?
Ooh.
Animals. We can get Studio Monkey.
We could have 100 children in rags swarm the stage.
Imagine that, the hecticness of these lights with the monkey running around. They'd fall over, wouldn't they?
There's already 3 monkeys in it. Honestly, don't need
going
to
stand
up
after.
But yeah, so we are, it is time for...
Speaking of Russia, here he is.
Well, if I can bloody find the bloody thing.
These are my confessions. So, I did my usual, right? I wouldn't quite say it was dumpster diving this week. It was a little bit more...
palatable.
Yeah, a little bit more wholesome. So, well,
arguably, as comfortable for you.
Yeah.
One's cold, one's hot. Either way, it's...
Yeah. It's not moderate.
So I had a little look around. I did.
Moderate.
I did explain to the boys earlier as well that it wasn't quite as easy as you might have imagined to find Valentine's Day confessions, because it just gets muddled up on the internet and people are just talking about the first time they confess their love for someone. And those stories aren't very interesting, so sorry.
No, not. They're very interesting to the person writing it, because they think they're the...
They're all in.
Yeah.
We'll come back to that. But I've got one little one that's a little bit wordy, so bear with me on it, but I'll try and run through it nice and quickly. But it's called Work Wife?
Oh, dear.
Okay. So it's Valentine's Day and I'm at work. A small group of us decide to have some post-work drinks to celebrate our collective singledom. Whilst out, a male colleague and I slip into some typical post-work chat with a sprinkle of light flirting. We've got a little history, parentheses. After a while, we start talking about how much of a dick my manager has been recently, and in fact, how much he is in general. Said manager is actually out with us on this night out, and while we're talking, I have a little look around to check the closest clear, and I lock eyes with him immediately.
So she's been talking about the manager, looks around.
Talking about a smack about him.
Damn.
Looks up, boom, laser beams. So panic ensues. He's within earshot, but I have no way of knowing if he heard us because the bar's quite loud. So struck with this awful sense of dread, I hastily decide to buy two drinks at the bar, one for him, one for me.
Oh, God.
In the hopes that if he did hear me, this little peace offering will get me out of trouble. Okay. Cut to 8 hours later. He's in the next room making me breakfast, and I think I'm in love with him.
Oh, God.
Work's going to be really interesting today.
So he was looking over for different reasons.
Yeah. He's probably seen that stray look from her and gone, oh.
That's my in.
Quit in. Yeah. And then she brings over two drinks.
Also, she folded quick.
Bloody hell.
He's a dick, is he?
She's in love with him now. Settle down.
Sometimes a fish just jumps into your net, doesn't it?
So I thought it was a bit of a roller coaster, right? Because initially I'm like, oh, she got this first guy. They've got a little bit going on. I'm not too sure what's going to happen with this. And then...
Yeah, when you called it work wife, you did dangle the rod there, didn't you? Rod. And I bit the wrong...
No, you were the wrong fish biting the same hook.
Something in there. Yeah. But I wonder what that guy, the first guy, thinks of her when he finds out.
Yeah. Like, also, probably trying to get in himself.
Of course he was.
Yeah. Let's just talk the boss.
Yeah. Common ground.
I mean, I think a lot of people now, currently, and have had the situation where at work, they're trying to hit it with, like, flirt with someone, and then someone else swoops in. And then you've all got to still work in that environment, yeah? So there's a bit of, like, an aftermath, you know, like the feelings.
Yeah, for
It's just a very... But also, the love triangles of a workplace, basically. Yeah, it's a bit mad.
And also you've got... She probably doesn't like him to work with, but then bought him a drink. He probably dropped his guard a little bit.
Opens up.
Then whatever. And also you've got alcohol. And also he's the manager, which people might say doesn't make a difference, but it does.
Mm.
It's like literally, statistically, that like... It was like some stats around like what women find attractive versus what men find attractive.
Yeah.
And like power is like unanimous across women. And that's not saying that they like powerful men, but some authority and the way they carry themselves that essentially equates to power, which makes total sense, right? We're looking for, if you look biologically, we're looking for a nurture because that's something that masculine doesn't have as much. That's the feminine energy. Mm. And a masculine energy is a bit more of a protector. Mm. Not saying that they need protecting, but you know, in terms of the basics. Yeah.
It's those natural genetic markers, which we probably have tried to evolve and move away
and
from.
Suppress.
But they're still certainly there.
Yeah.
They're still very much
100%. I remember Mark. So he was saying, like, he was, for everyone watching, we know him, good lad, funny guy, very funny guy, one-of-one type character. But he was a bodybuilder, massive. He used to say the amount of girls that were like, oh, bodybuilders aren't my type at all, it's too much. But then a few hours later, like this, because they'd see an arm and go, actually,
I like a bit of that.
I quite like how big that is. Yeah, so he's like, he said it all the time. He said the amount of times that people would literally come up to him saying, oh, that's too much for me. And he would be like, that was basically like a bullseye for me. Like, I'm gonna,
yeah.
Red rag to a bull, yeah.
So there we go. That one was kind of cute, kind of interesting.
Yeah, I like that.
I'd love to see like a follow-up on that, but I guess that'll never happen because it's the internet.
Yeah.
That person's probably dead now.
Sequels don't happen, yeah.
Person's dead. All three of them.
Now, the second one is something a little bit different, right? But just follow on with me because it was, I actually titled it Help. So
that's the name of your autobiography as well.
Well, I'm not asking for help, by the way, guys. Yeah, don't give me any advice. I don't take kindly to it. Sorry.
Yeah, he wants your criticism. That's what he wants. Doesn't want your advice.
Have you ever thought about?
How dare you speak to me? Right, so this chap here is basically just asking for help. So we'll try and give him some suggestions, hopefully.
Okay, maybe he could follow our Chinese friend's live plays and follow our advice.
Yeah, yeah. Love calling that guy out again, by the way. That's great. So, okay, so this guy, I was thinking about confessing to my crush on Valentine's Day. So the other day she told me how sad she'd been recently, but she didn't specify what was wrong or how things could improve. I didn't want to push the issue, so I tried to comfort her as best as I could. I really had a compulsion at that point in time to confess my feelings for her because part of me felt like it might make her feel better. I decided instead that this was inappropriate and I held off. I've sent her some flowers as a means of cheering her up instead, though I'm not sure how she'll receive the gesture. He basically tops it off by saying, in case you couldn't tell, I have absolutely no idea what I'm doing.
Yeah.
So help me out. Because he doesn't know what's
going on. I can relate to that.
Yeah, fair.
I've had a few moments of unrequited love in my life.
Okay.
Or at least when I was younger, I used to put people that on pedestals quite a lot.
Yeah.
So if I couldn't get it, I'd be like, well, when I do get it.
You did do that.
Yeah, when I do get it, it's going to be this thing and it's going to be like... And
did it work out?
You just... No. Obviously.
So don't pedestal people, man.
No, literally don't. But it's interesting because when you are in that space, your brain will work tricks on you because you'll go through this, take it easy. And then 10 minutes later, you're like, text her.
Yeah.
And
it's like, the overthinking of all of that is just a nightmare.
It's an awful, awful space to be in. And it's like, you'll never make a good decision when you're in that frame of mind.
No way.
So if you are in that frame of mind, ask someone that you really trust advice because you're not thinking clearly.
Or chill out a minute or I don't know. Or just do what you would go with your gut or natural. Yeah. And also... A wise man once said to me on a building site, if you hesitate, you masturbate.
Okay.
So get in there, son. Okay. Do you know what I mean?
Get in there, son.
Where is...
Get them pants on, boy.
Nah.
49, get in there.
And you can apply that to all areas of life, you know?
But it all always comes back to masturbating.
No. It's not... No, well... Yeah. No, if you take it to mean... Well, yes, but like...
Let him figure it out. Go on. What are you going to say?
Love an animation of his brain right now. What's going in there?
Like if you're driving, you know, be assertive. Get in that, like, see the space, get in there.
Yeah,
you hesitate, you masturbate. You want to be sat there for towelling along those.
Cause a pile-up is what you're saying.
No.
Yeah, but that's not always good advice because sometimes, right, if she wasn't in a great state of mind, the last thing that she's not ready for anything else right now.
Yeah, but I'm talking about giving her the flowers or telling her that he likes her. Yeah, she might not be in a great state of mind, but what he's doing isn't really going to make her feel worse, I don't think.
Yeah, but there's a time and a place, right? If someone's going through something, they're not in a position to then jump to the next guy, whatever. Like, you rather would go start something when you're both on an even keel.
Yeah, so sometimes masturbating is the right way out. Hesitate.
Definitely sometimes.
Bit of clarity of the mind.
Yeah.
So,
bit of PNC.
And see my breakdown of that. So the way I looked at it was, he's obviously got a measure of emotional intelligence because he's decided that wasn't the right time.
Yeah, exactly.
He was absolutely right. That's just not the right time.
Fucking onion, you are, isn't you?
What you mean?
You go deep. You break everything down to its molecules, don't you? So good. It's great. I love it.
So he's got that to him, which means he's obviously, typically people like that are quite sound because they do think of things like that and they're quite conscientious. He just needs to maybe get out of his own way a little bit in the next time he thinks it's an appropriate time and just go forward and do it. But is he already maybe in the friend zone? Quite possibly.
Quite possibly. Yeah. And I don't think any girl... I mean, this is probably wrong, but if you're not, because as a girl as well, you'll know if someone fancies you around you. And if you genuinely don't, random flowers out of nowhere might not do that. What you're better off probably doing is going, let's go for a drink.
Mm.
Go for a drink. Start putting a few little flirty moments out there, a few touches, a few compliments.
Mm.
Just see how they come back. Because you'll read someone straight away.
That's very true. Also, flowers, you're not in the room to read the flower.
No, they could be... I was bought something once and it was in the kind of 2020 days. Someone sent me something and it could have been cute and it icked me out so bad. And I was like, whoa, no.
Oh.
But then I felt really guilty because I was like, oh, I wish you didn't send that because now I don't...
Yeah.
Now I've got to say something, and it's like, and you know, she could react to the flowers that way. So at least if you do something in person, you can read the body language. If he is tuned in like you're saying he could be, then read it, and then have a few more drinks. And then blame it on the alcohol if you make a tit of yourself.
Blame
then,
it on that.
But also, there's nothing wrong with making it, like you said, once there is time to make your shot, make it. If you miss,
just
don't fine. Shoot, you don't score, innit?
There's no, yeah.
What's that Gretzky quote? You miss all the shots you don't take.
Yeah, there you go.
100% of the shots you don't get, something like that. Anyway, take your shot, lad.
Exactly.
You'll be all right.
And good luck to you.
Yeah. And let us know how you get on. Even though
but what you said was right. If you're in a situation like that, ask your mates. If in doubt, you haven't got any mates, ask us. We'll tell you.
Yeah, exactly.
Honestly.
But yeah,
I'll go for a drink with you.
Yeah, so.
I do feel for people that are in that boat of Valentine's Day, but I just think it's tacky. Don't wait till Valentine's Day to do these things. It's like proposing on Valentine's Day. I just find that so tacky, man. Like,
you build it up to too
you're building
much.
It up.
Too much pressure.
And also, if you are single, my best advice if for singletons, Valentine's Day, get yourself to the gym after work, because every girl in there will most likely be single.
Oh.
So then you can see if you like anyone in there, not in like a creepy way, but you'll at least have a, now I know who is single in here.
I don't like gym relations.
No, I'm not saying, but like, but for some people, that's a place of meeting people. A lot of people meet in the gym.
Yeah.
But if you're in the gym on a Wednesday night, when this comes out, you're listening to Chew the Fat and you spot someone that's nice, you know, at least then you've, okay, there's one that, if I happen to see her, I can say hello and be a little bit more.
Very true. If you see them in a more appropriate place, then
exactly.
Yeah, exactly. It's a good place to meet, to be fair. Also, speed dating.
Oh, you've done speed dating, haven't you?
God.
Every time I ever watch speed dating is when I watch autistic people do it on like Undateables and Love on the Spectrum and stuff.
What's great about them is that they're so to the point about it. That's how you do it properly.
Mate, on the last season of Love on the Spectrum, which I love. And before anyone tries to come at me, not in a take the mickey way, it's brilliant.
It's wholesome, isn't it, in a way, yeah.
This guy called Connor on the last series, he's amazing. He has a sword collection.
Oh, hell yeah.
But he would fit in so well on this podcast when we talk about movies.
Oh, hell yeah.
I'll show you some clips afterwards. He's brilliant.
My boy.
He loves Michael Bay, though, because, I mean, that's
his audience. Like things blowing up in like slow motion boobs.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
He goes, now I think of it, Michael Bay is quite into explosions, isn't he? I'm like, yes, he is.
What a lad, yes.
But he basically likes the outdoors, right? And you know, with autism, it's like, it's all or nothing on these couple of things. If I love Transformers and she likes it, that's all we need.
And vice versa,
if I love something and she doesn't, this will never work.
Yes.
And he goes to this one girl and he's like, so do you like the outdoors? And she's like, no, I'm more of a city girl, actually. And he literally just puts a big fat X in the no column while she's looking at him. and then he goes, okay. And then they move on and the producer goes, Connor, maybe next time, wait until they leave to put the X. And he went, oh, did I do it in front of her? And he's like, yeah. And then, because autism, obviously, you don't know how to pick up social cues, do you? That's where you're weak. But like, just the brutality of like seeing that. He still went on a few dates there afterwards, though.
Good
he called
man,
her up and said, I think I was too hasty.
Good, brilliant. Yes. I'd like to see that.
Brilliant.
Anyway, it's time for... This, my friend Melissa sent me this on last week, and it's just brilliant. But also, there's a small link to Valentine's Day, because it's kind of Frank Ocean-y. But this guy has a... this guy makes videos. He's called The Rapping Chef. And he basically makes songs about how he makes stuff. He's actually, by the looks of it, he's a decent cook.
Yeah.
I don't like the look of that.
But, so these are cinnamon buns.
I made cinnamon rolls today, I usually never bake. Excuse the mess I made, I'll show you how I made them. Melt a little butter, add milk and some sugar. Then add
dry
yeast and when it bubble, I think it's ready. Oh no, 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 add the eggs and flour. No, let it sit an hour. It'll double up in size. Double, right. And then I roll it out with a bottle of wine. Cause I don't have a rolling pin. Ooh.
rap and chef made it. I roll it, I'ma need dental floss, but I'm not flossing. Got some cream cheese powder, sugar, and milk. That's for the frosting. Put the oven on 350, but wait, yeah, let me caution. Gotta cover them for the first 15 minutes so they don't get too brown and outer.
Wow, that was better than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah, actually,
for sure.
Really, I tell you what, there's more on his account that are brilliant.
And
he
nails them all. Like,
yeah,
that,
he hits every beat. It's so good.
Right, I wonder how much thought he has to put into the, like you can't just do that off the bat.
Oh, sure, no.
Like, the wine for the rolling pin.
Did I use the wine bottle? No, a bottle of wine. Because I was thinking the whole time, what's he going to do to hit that note?
Oh, man. Brilliant.
Yeah, we'll rapping
show. That was good.
Link
that
guy's video and we'll donate that man a bloody rolling pin as well.
Yeah. I think he makes better songs without it.
And an auto tuner. I'm joking. I just.
But I just found it was making me, I was wetting myself. I was going through so many of his videos and they're all like that, just taking like old, like, you know, R&B hip hop songs. Oh, it's just great. It's so like funny. But he actually makes half decent food as well, which kind of makes it fun. But
it's time, the top 10.
Oh, top 10.
I forgot we were
back
doing
again.
This.
Yeah. We are doing top 10 rom-coms. So, as always, what we do is we set out our stalls of what we, our criteria is for judging this, right? Mm. So, what would you say, Dean, is essential for you when watching and rating a rom-com? What makes a good rom-com?
That it's romantic and a comedy. I don't know.
Ben, how about you?
Okay, so I'll go in with...
He's not wrong.
He's actually spot on. But okay, so I would say it has to be something that stands up on its own as a film and is not held up purely by the premise that it's a rom-com.
That's what I was about to say.
Okay, cool.
I felt like, you know, in church where it's like, Jesus loves you, and it's like when you take the call back.
Get an amen.
What's the one? All the time. You know that one? Anyway, when you said that, I wanted to be like, holler and preach.
Yeah. Gotcha.
Because many just hinge on, you know.
Oh, people will watch it because it's a rom-com.
Yeah.
People will just come and watch this. So no, we're not doing that. Mm. And also, it has to be, I guess for me, actually, the pendulum swings more to it being a comedy than a romance film. That's kind of...
I was going to say, what percentage?
Yeah, I'm probably on a 70-30% split.
Okay.
You'll see that by the films I've chosen.
Yeah, so I'm going to just expand on that because I don't disagree with that at all. I think number one for me is chemistry between the leads. Like a genuine chemistry is so important.
Yeah.
It looks like they're having a real fun time doing it.
That's
and you hear a lot about actors hooking up on rom-coms because they're having so much fun doing it, and then a lot of them
Mr. and
have
Mrs.
done.
Smith.
Exactly. For me, it's got to be, if it's going to be have comedy in the name, it's got to be actually funny.
Yep.
What I mean by that is not just funny because it's funny for a rom, for a romantic film. Like, no, the funny bits have to be actually funny. From both the man and the woman.
It's still a comedy.
Yeah, exactly. Which is kind of what you say has to be a good film. And then I think having equal characters, and what I mean here is, when you have some rom-coms that are like, the woman's amazing, the guy's bumbling through. Like, I think the best rom-coms and the ones that are on my list are when the women and the men give as good as they get.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because there's always a narrative and an arc, right? Where they're never going to get together. They realise they're right for each other. There's an obstacle. They get over it and they get together at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much all
fall
to
that.
So an example of a bad one, and I hope this isn't one of your choices, is Knocked Up.
Yes.
Because you've got...
You're safe.
You've got one who just seems really likable and lovable as a character, and the other one just seems
neurotic,
like a complete nightmare. So
Catherine Hyde was that nightmare in every film.
Because it's just probably how she is. But but completely unbalanced. So yes.
So that's our criteria.
Okay.
And really, as well, 90s to mid-noughties is the golden time for this, right?
It's the cringe. 100%.
It's really weird because it used to be every good-looking lead, male and female, would do a couple of rom-coms, and it wouldn't necessarily, you wouldn't get stuck in that typecast. You know, some big names have done rom-coms. You know, there's no, it's not like a, it's not a disservice to your acting career.
No.
But now it just doesn't seem to happen. I don't know if the writing just has dried up and it's more about these big hard-hitting franchises, but.
Yeah.
I've got an opposite take to that, to be honest.
Okay.
With you. I think the best ones, but I guess I'm not an aficionado. I haven't seen as many rom-coms as you guys probably have. I think some of the best ones are some of the more recently made ones.
Okay. That's interesting. So you're going to be more biased recent then?
A little bit, but okay. Then you'll see my list doesn't actually speak to that completely, but you know,
we'll go with it. Right, what we're going to do is we're going to do one each, and we're going to give a top three, and then we're going to go honourable mentions, and then we're going to give you our top 10. So Dean, why don't you kick us off with your all-time favourite romantic comedy?
Do you want to go 3-2-1 or are you going to go 1-2-3?
Nah, go 1-2-3.
I don't know if I have a number one.
Well, say one.
Okay.
But I'm going to give you one of them that is probably up there, and 40-year-old Virgin.
Okay. Yeah, so that one for me is definitely more of a comedy, which answers the bit you said. Yep. And the romance side, I suppose the ending is romantic, isn't
bit
it?
Bit of an arc in it.
Like yeah, and it is all about romance ultimately.
Some good characters in that too, you know. What we love in films essentially is some good quotable lines in it.
Tons of them.
It's not all about cock and balls, you know, like
two bags of sand.
Yeah, exactly. There you go. That's my 2 pence on that one. Okay. There you go. 40-year-old Virgin, yeah.
So my number one is the movie Crazy Stupid Love.
Didn't make it in mine.
Didn't make it to the list, right?
Doesn't mean I don't like it. I like it.
I think as an overall film, it's a very good film as it stands. And it just happens to be a rom-com.
Yeah. No,
I like that film.
My girlfriend doesn't like that film.
Oh, really?
Really doesn't. And I don't really know why, because I like it. Because you got Ryan Gosling playing a character that only really Ryan Gosling and a few others can play.
Yeah.
But does it really well.
Phenomenally well, yeah.
Really good writing, and where it all comes together. The end scene's hilarious.
And Steve Carell being a versatile enough actor to be able to do the opposite journey.
Yeah.
It's amazing as well.
Yeah, I enjoyed that.
Great cast.
Yeah.
Great work on scene. Yeah, great.
So my all-time, there's no question this was my number one when we did this. So if we look at my chemistry, 10 out of 10. Equal characters, 10 out of 10. And actual humour, 10 out of 10. It is How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days. If Kate Hudson and Matthew McConaughey. What a movie. Oh my God. It gets me every time. It's phenomenal. It's phenomenal.
I'm trying to think if I can remember watching it ever.
I haven't seen it.
You've never seen it?
I don't think I've seen it.
Oh my God. It is head and shoulders the best.
I love Matthew McConaughey. So
the premise is her name's Annie. I can't remember what her name is now. But Kate Hudson's character, she writes for a women's magazine. Matthew McConaughey is an ad man, but like an exec. And he's proper in sports. Like, he's throwing ideas around and he's Matthew McConaughey.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then he has a bet with some mates that he can't get a girl to fall in love with him in 10 days. Mm. She has like an inverse bet where she tries to get a guy to fall in love with her. And they kind of, and then it all does this. So they're all playing each other up.
Mm.
Her thing is how to lose a guy in 10 days. Mm. So that's her column.
So she's trying to deflect and he's trying to attract.
Yeah, so he's putting up with more than he needs to because he's trying to win this bet.
Okay.
But she's doing way more to get rid of him. Like for example,
and then opposites attract.
Yes, to a basketball game and she like makes him go for drinks and stuff when it's the middle of like the main part of the game. He's like, I'll do it. Obviously, you know, no spoilers because it's a rom-com, but they do fall in love. And it's really nice. Yeah, you know it's going to happen. So that is my number one. Not even, the number two and three don't even come close.
Okay.
It's the movie that brings me the most happiness when it comes to rom-coms.
Matthew
McConaughey, what a guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, brilliant. This is, this could actually be my number one. The Breakup with Jennifer Aniston.
Yes.
Yeah. Awful. Okay, sorry.
I mean,
good characters.
I've just seen it the most out of all the ones that I can think of, you know? So for that to be my number one. But I just think that
it's when he has like a company with his brothers.
Like, I just
think the tourism company, right?
Yeah.
And she wants him to commit. Is that, and he doesn't commit. Is it something like that?
No, she asks him to like get ready for dinner and he wants to just come home after work and play games and stuff. He's basically just being a fucking big kid.
Yeah.
And it all just blows up and then they're trying to live together and he's having strippers around.
Yeah. Smoking cigars and
it's just...
Should film about a breakup. Yeah.
Yeah, but
it's funny, man. Like,
good leads as well.
Favreau's in it, whatever you have. You said it's
John Favreau.
Yeah.
All right.
Anyway.
My number two... It's pro-commies if I'd forgotten.
Go
go on, your turn. 40-year-old virgin was by number two. Okay. So I'm not going to, for the sake of time, I won't bother giving you like the full backstory of it, but I will then say what my number three was instead, which is There's Something About Mary.
Yeah. Oh, Lee Evans.
I forgot about Lee that Evans, film. Geez.
Lee Evans playing an American disabled man who's actually English the whole time.
Ridiculous.
Brilliant.
Who's the other guy that puts the fake teeth in? What's that actor called?
Is he in...
You know the one.
Is he in...
He's great in it. He's the other one that's tricking Mary.
He's in
Mary.
That Jim Carrey film, isn't it? Yeah.
He's in
Me, Myself and Irene. Is in that
film? Yeah.
Wait, which guy are we talking about?
Something.
We're not talking about
he's the douche
Hank
that tries to like put
Simpsons.
Him off the scent of her.
No, right? Not Hank Azaria. Yeah, he's a proper douche in it. Matt Dillon.
Oh, he's very good. Yeah. Spot on.
Yeah, Matt Dillon in it. He's good.
Yeah.
And then Ben Stiller's just there picking up pieces.
See, this is the problem with rom-coms. There's just a lot of good ones.
Yeah.
Man. There's a lot.
There are. That was in my notables. I basically not sure my top three. I didn't like this movie, but I watched it over Christmas and I really loved it. And I'm going to be a bit like Jack Grealish, but I just love Pretty Woman.
Oh, God.
It is a great movie.
My mum wouldn't stop badgering me to watch that.
It is a brilliant movie, though. Great art. It's a great art to it. It's fun. It's not as funny as it's more of a rom than a com.
Definitely.
But yeah, I think Pretty Woman's.
It's kind of in the Bodyguard.
I feel like I'm
for me.
No, Bodyguard's way deeper.
Okay. Yeah,
I feel like I'm.
In fact, that's not a com at all.
To be honest, I'm going to let him have it for now. But I wouldn't normally have said that was a rom com at all.
Pretty Woman.
Yeah.
If you Google rom coms, it's definitely
could,
in
could
there.
Well be. Yeah.
It's low on the com.
Julia Roberts is in her bag in that. She's so good.
Yeah. See, I never liked Julia Roberts. Big, but mouth's too big for her face. But in that. But in that, she is
10/10.
She's a caricature's dream.
Yo. You'd be like, it's Julia Roberts. Stick to your profession.
Telling all the guys, guess what I got today?
The pencil's shaking.
The work does itself.
All right, then your third, Dean.
Good old classic, 10 Things I Hate About You.
Yeah.
I can't believe it took this long for it to come out, to be honest.
Yeah.
But I think that could be number one. Like I said, I don't have a number one, but...
Julia Stiles?
Stiles? Yeah,
and Heath Ledger.
And
the guy that's now a big actor
got a double-barreled name, was in 500 Days... Robin...
Oh, Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Him, yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
The little bro. Is the younger brother, right? No.
No, he's the friend of...
Who's trying to go out. Anyway, brilliant film.
Yeah, great film.
With the little sister, isn't it? They're two sisters, right? And he's trying to go with the younger sister. The dad's like jokes in that as well.
Yeah, because he's got that's right. Mm. Yeah, because he's got two daughters. One is hates love. One's wants to be the prom queen.
She was cute, isn't it? The youngest at the time. Obviously.
That's a
great film.
Heath Ledger's brilliant as well.
Yeah, he's actually blind and he wasn't that.
Yeah, he was gone. He was taken from us too soon, really. He would have had a hell of a middle-aged man acting career if he was still alive.
100%.
Because he's got range.
He'd be in everything.
Yeah.
He literally would be.
12th Night, another rom-com? Deadpool, rom-com?
No. More action comedy.
Actually, Deadpool, it's kind of...
I wouldn't say...
Pulls on the strings a little bit.
I think it's an action comedy.
The romance ends early in that one.
The entire driver of the story is romance.
Yeah.
Isn't it, almost?
Anti-romance, isn't it? It's two people that shouldn't be. Mm. Yeah, and then they have that little paintballing scene and they're rolling around in the hay.
It's kind of cute. Yeah.
I love love. Don't you just...
Well, what's your third?
Yeah. No, that was your. It's your one now.
No, I've done my three.
Well, no, you throw another one because Dean's said one.
Oh, I'll just pull one out of the bag.
Well, you had a list of
But they were honourable mentions. I'm not going to have you steal my one. So I have what I'll say is A Knight's Tale. I'm going to throw in there. You know the one? Heath Ledger again.
Isn't that what I just said?
Yeah, you said 12th Night.
Oh, I meant to say
Is that what
Tale.
You meant?
No,
I won't say that either then.
No, I was just...
Knight's Tale with Paul Brittany.
Paul Bettany.
Bettany,
I think is a phenomenal
who's
actor.
Shakespeare.
By the way. Yeah, he's so good. No, all right then.
Hold on.
I'm going to say Just Friends instead.
Can I just say...
If you're going to be blunt with me...
Ryan Reynolds.
Mr. Clayton.
Ryan Reynolds?
Yes.
The Christmas one where he goes home.
Yeah.
Watched it over Christmas.
Yeah.
Loved it.
It's so good.
It's just great.
So good.
Ryan Reynolds fat.
With Anna Faris.
Anna Faris, who's nuts in it.
Crackers.
Good film that.
Is that good when they piss in the thing well? And they cross piss and no. they piss and they all switch?
No, Ryan Reynolds basically has like a small town sweetheart, but now he's like an LA music exec. He goes back with Anna Faris, who's like a crazy pop star, and he's trying to sign her. And he gets stuck in the ice at his old hometown, goes into a bar, sees the girl he used to fancy, but he could never get near her because he was the fat kid.
Mm. And they were best friends. Yeah.
And it's the guy from American Pie.
Chris Klein,
who gets so many mentions on this podcast.
Because he's great.
He's brilliant in that. When he makes a song about her. When you smile.
And then he's singing the same song to another girl later in the film.
Yeah. On the voice note. Yeah, great. That's good. So I've got, how's this going 10 days? Pretty well, 10 things about you. So we'll go into some notable mentions now because you kind of said some of mine as well. But Love Actually, I know it's probably more of a Christmas film. Brilliant.
Oh, I've never seen it.
In that same ilk, Notting Hill.
I've not seen it either.
I mean, they're just, British classic.
They're the ones.
And then the more modern one I put is Friends with Benefits with Mila Kunis and JT.
What's the other film that's almost
No
like
Strings Attached?
Yeah,
but this is better.
Oh, is it?
But again, I think the chemistry between Justin Timberlake and Mila Kunis is really good.
But Justin Timberlake as an actor, huh?
Mm. Yeah, don't mind him in that. It is good. A bit more of a modern premise. Mm. I've been watching a few rom-coms recently with my girlfriend, just going back through like the 90s ones. And some of the male-female stereotypes are pretty bad.
Yeah.
They've dated quite badly.
Yeah. Like the jock type. I mean,
the fact that the girls just always want to get married. The guys are like it's very cliche. Mm-hmm.
What was that movie with Josh Hartnett where he has to be no sex?
40 Days and 40 Nights. Right. Where he gets raped at the end.
He gets raped at the end.
Oh, right. Yeah.
That's really bad.
He gets actually raped.
Yeah.
And I'm like.
And they put it in a movie.
It's done for laughs almost.
Yeah. Ah, crazy. I bet that main girl's a bit of you, isn't she? The dark and mysterious one.
She's phenomenal, yeah. I remember. Yeah.
Yeah. It's the washing machine dream he has at the end.
Is that the same girl from A Knight's Tale?
Don't know.
Shannon Sossaman.
There it is. Ding, 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 ding.
If you're watching Sharon, yes, you didn't just mention. Shannon.
Sharon.
Jesus. How'd you come up with this?
I know. Plucking, the name plucker.
I wonder if it's the same person. Anyway,
I'm going to throw a little curveball out there. Love and Basketball.
Oh, that's a good show.
Never seen that. I've seen, I know.
You're
going to
like, you'd like that. But it's super, the arc is super, it's very arcy, isn't it?
Very arc.
So Stephen, you know, they both obviously love basketball, and then basically her pursuit of becoming a basketball player couldn't stop them getting together. And it's like, if I go and meet him, I'm going to not start in the team because I'll be out.
Well, distracted.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So obviously, they're trying, maybe the premise, like being a woman, you shouldn't be able to go and do sports and have a man sort of thing. I don't know. Maybe that hasn't aged too well, but like, yeah, that was a good film.
Some good ones in there. Why don't we come back and give the guys our top 10?
Perfect.
This is Chew the Fat Top 10 Rom-Coms.
In at 10 is Pretty Woman.
In at 9, the British classic Love Actually.
In at 8, it's Knight's Tale.
At number 7, Just Friends.
In at 6, another one, Notting Hill.
In at 5, it's Crazy, Stupid, Love.
In at 4, it's 40-Year-Old Virgin.
Number 3, How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days.
Number 2, There's Just Something About Mary.
And number 1, the classic, 10 Things I Hate About You.
Oh, there we go.
What a list.
Romantic comedies.
Comedies with a bit of romance.
Yes.
You don't get better than that. It's a very comprehensive list, boys.
There Good we job. Go.
Something for everyone in there.
Something for everyone. If you're single, in a relationship, doesn't matter. Because they're not too romantic that if you're single, you're going to be pulling your hair out.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
But they are funny enough that they'll get you through this tough day.
Especially my ones.
Especially, because your ones are always more important, even though you've not really seen the many rom-coms. So, on that list...
Knives Out, that should have been on there. God damn.
No, it should not.
I know it's not.
On that list, What ones do you need to look, need to watch there? I've seen all of them.
What ones do I need to watch? Yeah. Well, what ones do I need to watch and will watch is probably, I'll eventually get around to watching Notting Hill.
Notting Hill is, yeah, it's, I think it's a classic film. It's very, also,
the Britishness.
Very British. Through,
you know, yeah. A lot of rom-coms that we've mentioned are American generally, aren't they? So to add a, throw a bit of
I mean,
British splash.
You've got a splash of American in it with Julia Roberts, but.
Oh, I didn't know she was in it. Oh. I'll watch one of those two. I will not watch Notting Hill and Love Actually. I'll watch one of them and I'll make that decision soon. Yeah.
Watch Notting Hill.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
It's higher in the list.
Yeah.
By default, it's the better one, right? I need to watch Just Friends, to be honest. I don't think I've seen that.
Just Friends is, I rewatched it. It's on Netflix. So I rewatched it at Christmas. Good Christmas movie as well, yeah. If you're stuck for that. Well, funny Christmas movie.
Right up your street. You'll enjoy that.
Nice.
Here's the list of the worst rom-coms.
Yeah, the breakup didn't make it. The breakup didn't make it. It's like a anti rom com, I guess.
There's
isn't
some great cameos in the breakup.
So, to wrap, because it's been quite a long episode, because we've done our top tens.
Yeah, yeah.
But Valentine's Day, for some, time for love, time for all the things that make your insides warm. But it's not always fun for everyone, is it?
Probably not.
Probably a lot of people out there have a pretty bad day.
Okay.
Oh.
Not many people have had much worse day than the guy I'm about to show you, though.
Oh, no.
This is a clip from Jerry Springer.
Oh, no.
Jerry.
And I'm going to end on this, basically, as the anti-love clip that just made me laugh this week. It was a close contender for Laugh the Week.
When I went to the bachelorette party, right? Okay. Well, there was a guy there. I ended up sleeping with him. But, I mean, you don't come up and touch me. I mean, you don't come up and just give me a kiss because you want to. It's, deflect you know, it. It's just not
It's your fault.
It's his fault.
I don't know.
Well, I've switched jobs. I work 10-hour, 12-hour shifts. When I come home working in 100-degree heat, I'm exhausted and tired. I want sometimes I just want to take a shower and relax.
You know this other guy?
No, he doesn't.
You want to tell him who he is?
It was a dancer. It was one of the dancers. Yes.
What kind of dancer?
He was a stripper.
Here he is. Here's mine.
No worries.
Camera. Wow.
What is happening?
Wow. Also,
I slept with a midget slipper. Stripper was
I slept with a midget stripper.
Imagine his day thinking, it's bad enough you cheated on me. And then he comes out, proceeds to play up to the crowd and strip.
Oh, it's just so disrespectful.
This is a woman I love.
The worst one.
You went it too hard for a start.
Yeah, you just knocked it through the table. How,
that's just been done for telly, Eric. Please say it.
Jerry Springer.
I mean, I hasn't, though.
Jerry Springer is one of them ones where you think, this can't be real. But then you realise that if Jeremy Kyle has that many weirdos, America has...
True.
It just goes on. It's infinite.
Midget strippers are very feasible, aren't they, really?
You just couldn't get me to... I couldn't be the guy. There's no way that I'm sitting there and having the conversation.
Yeah, yeah, on TV.
On TV in front of all of these people.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And especially when the small person stripper comes out, I'm already out of the building. I'm throwing him six rows.
Here's
a question for you, right? Where do you stand on, right, normally if someone sleeps with your girlfriend, I don't always think you should punch that guy, for example, because... it's actually her fault.
Mm.
And I'm not saying she should punch her either, but like she's the one that's, if he's single, doesn't know you, it's really not, you can't have a go at the guy.
Yeah, right.
You know, if your girl's just gone and slept with someone on the night out that didn't know her, fair play to him. He's done nothing wrong in my opinion. Mm. And vice versa for men and women. But do you punch the little man stripper?
No, you do not punch the little man stripper.
Because you're not winning, you're not coming off well in that either,
are you? You're coming off even worse now.
Or do you grab by the ankle and give him a... give him a toss.
You've just got to take the L.
Give him a toss. He's already
hammer throw.
He's already had a toss.
What, like out of Austin Powers? And then he throws him and he goes bong like after.
Wee.
Crikey.
What'd you do?
Just take the L and leave the studio.
You take the L and you leave.
Take the L in front of national television.
Take the L and just leave.
Move countries.
You took the L by turning up for the show.
Yeah.
See you later.
Yeah, we've been having some marital issues. We're not going to tell you exactly what. I'm going to wait until we're on, the cameras are rolling.
Yeah, yeah.
No. No, you're not.
No, you're not. I've signed us up to Jerry Springer. Have you fuck?
You they later. Must get offered a sum of money, right? It must be the way.
I don't pay you for Jeremy Kyle. And I don't think, well, maybe they did.
What money are they going to give
they
that
They pay
man?
You what expenses could, for yeah, traveling. Right.
So like a trip.
The travel.
Well, did they go cost. Fucking Carl's Jr. on the way?
Hey, that's quite, yeah, nice. Carl's Jr.
Just keep the receipt for that burger, son. Jerry's paying for that.
Well.
Do you want fries with that?
I think we should wrap there in the interest of time.
Right, Bob, yeah.
In the interest of time.
My work here
right.
is done.
For singles, lovers, and everyone in between, have a lovely Valentine's Day. Hope this episode has given you a little bit of love and a little bit of humour and a little bit of whatever that was.
Hope it spiced up your relationship.
Yeah, exactly. But episode 19, Valentine's Day special in the bag. Mm. We will all see you next week.
Appreciate it.